A very good morning to one and all. I, Shad Mazdar, take immense pleasure to welcome our esteemed speaker, Dr. Shekhar C. Mahanandre, Secretary, Department of Scientific and Industrial Research and Director General Council of Scientific and Industrial Research. Honorable Director, MNIT Allahabad, Professor Rajat Tripathi, Deans, Heads of Various Departments, Faculty, Alumni, Students, guests and other participants to this webinar being conducted as a part of the Diamond Jubilee celebration of MNIT Allahabad. Motilal Nehru National Institute of Technology is an institute with total commitment to quality and excellence in academic pursuits. It was established as one of the 17 regional engineering colleges of India in the year 1961. With the enactment of National Institute of Technology Act 2007, the institute has been granted the status of institution of national importance. The institute celebrated the commencement of Diamond Jubilee of its establishment on December 2, 2019. Honorable Mr. Justice Sri Govind Mathurji, Chief Justice of Allahabad High Court, was the chief guest of the function. This celebration is in fact a great opportunity for all of us for reviewing the determination to achieve great heights in imparting quality education, research and other services towards the national building. With this in mind, let us begin the Diamond Jubilee lecture series, and I hope that you all find this experience highly engaging, fruitful and beneficial. I would like to invite Dean Research and Consultancy and Resource Generation and International Affairs and Member Diamond Jubilee Celebration Committee, Professor Dipika, for the welcome address.
Thank you, Sharma. A very good morning to all. Our very learned speaker of today's session, Dr. Manji, our Visionary Director, Professor Rajiv Tripathi, all deans, heads, faculty colleagues, students, alumni and guests, it is my extreme privilege and pleasure to welcome you all to this first scientific address under Diamond Jubilee Lecture Series. It is a great honor to have amongst us a visionary and an astute scholar like Professor Mandi. Friends, I just want to share the three words which you can also see on our logo, Siddhir Bhavati Karmacha. These three words drawn from Srimad Bhagavad Gita, which is a doctrine on the importance of karma. These three words are not merely a motto, not on our logo. They actually depict the very personality of this premier institution, the philosophy of our life. It is the character that we have been trying to enlive since our inception. We began our journey, as has been told to you, 60 years ago with 3 UG programs and 100 students. 60 years down the line, now today we offer 9 UG courses, 24 PG courses and PhD programs in virtually every stream of engineering, technology, sciences, humanities and management. This has been a long, glorious journey, and during these 60 years, the institute has crossed multiple milestones and created many landmarks and has produced and provided a long trail of illustrious alumni to this nation who have served the country in multiple positions like heads of Navratna companies, Bharatna companies, private blue chip companies. They have created their own enterprises and added to the entrepreneurial skill. They have also been working for the upliftment of society. So this is a great honor today that we are celebrating our Diamond Jubilee year. In the topic of today's lecture is role of science and technology and innovation in modern society. I would like to just share one major achievement which happened in this Diamond Jubilee year, and that too during the pandemic which created a disaster unseen by recent memory. But our young faculty, they emerged stronger. And जो हमारे प्रधानमंत्री जी ने माननीय प्रधानमंत्री जी ने कहा था चुनौती में संभावनाएं, सो दे सॉ अपॉर्चुनिटी ऑफ क्रिएटिंग डिवाइसेस टू सेफगार्ड द लाइव्स ऑफ पीपल अगेंस्ट दिस डेडली डिजीज डेडली वायरस वेदर एट वर्क प्लेस और एट होम. इन द सेम सीरीज आई जस्ट मेंशन वन इवेंट that is also unique in the history of this institution, that under the leadership of our director, we have entered the first ever technology transfer agreement, which has been materialized successfully. The product has been launched and is being very well received in High Court of Allahabad, AG's office, to mention few big buyers, besides large number of individual buyers. So this has been just the first of its kind, but this is not the last. And since then, we are continuously looking forward to multiple other technology transfer agreements. One is already finalized and the others are in the process. I will not take much of your time because I know that all of us are anxiously waiting for a very insightful session. So I once again welcome you all. I thank you for joining us to share our moment of pride and pleasure. I would conclude with what Ved says, Ma kashchit dukh bhag bhavet. Kahi bhi dukh na ho, कोई भी दुखी ना हो. अगर हम साइंस टेक्नोलॉजी और इनोवेशन को इस स्पिरिट से सोसाइटी के लिए यूज कर सकेंगे तो यही हमारा सबसे बड़ा अचीवमेंट होगा. नमस्कार, धन्यवाद, जय हिंद.
थैंक यू मैम फॉर दिस वेरी इंफॉर्मेटिव टॉक. नाउ मे आई टेक द प्रिविलेज टू इनवाइट डायरेक्टर एम एन एन आई टी अलाहाबाद Professor Rajiv Tripathi sir to say a few words.
Namaskar. Am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Yes.
Right. So, distinguished speaker of Diamond Jubilee celebrations, inaugural lecture series, Dr. Shekhar C. Mande, all heads of the departments, my faculty colleagues, participants, and my dear students. It's my privilege to welcome you, sir, on this occasion of Golden Jubilee Lecture Series. Rather, I'll say inaugural lecture series. You are the first who is going to inaugurate this lecture series. And I, on my personal behalf and on behalf of the institution, I welcome you, sir, to this webinar. And in fact, during the Diamond Jubilee celebration, we planned a lot of activities in campus, but because of this pandemic situation, we could not materialize this. Thanks to the technology, and we thought that let us move ahead with the online meetings, online lectures, online deliberations, and that is how we started this. As far as the topic is concerned, the topic is very relevant. Science, technology, they cannot work in isolation. If there is no science, there is no technology. And if there is no technology, there is no innovation. And we are not a developed nation, we are a developing nation. So we have plenty of opportunities in and around our system, and we can observe, we can use the technology, we can drive it to innovation stage and provide the low cost solution for the benefit of the society in general. And that is what is being motivated and inculcated in our students in this campus. And I am proud to share that around 9 startup companies are being run from the hostels by the students on different issues which are very relevant for the social cause. I am confident that the motivation lecture which the students will be listening from you, sir, that will further motivate them and they will be motivated to work on this innovation, use of technology for different applications, which is the demand of today. Our Prime Minister has also said that we need to have local and we need to have vocal for local. And as Professor Deepika has informed that we have already traveled long journey of 60 years with different achievements, different milestones which we have obtained. Primarily, this was, as you are aware, primarily this was mainly the UG teaching institution. And since 2003, we started master program were there, but many more number of master's programs were added and regular PhD admission started from 2003 and now we are having around 24 different master's programs, 9 programs of undergraduate and almost all the 14 departments, they are actively involved in research activities and students are also motivated by its research experiences in the department. I am confident that your interactive sessions will be very beneficial to all the participants, including the students, faculty, and other stakeholders of this institute. So once again, I welcome you, sir, and I thank you very much for providing this opportunity to us to spare your time. So I'm not going to take much of your time. I would love to listen to you, sir. Thank you. Thank you all.
Thank you very much, sir. Now, we have with us Dr. Shekhar C. Mande, who is current Director General of Council of Scientific and Industrial Research and Secretary of Department of Scientific and Industrial Research. He did his MSc in Physics from University of Nagpur. He holds a Doctoral of Philosophy in Molecular Biophysics from the Indian Institute of Science. And following his PhD, he joined as a Postdoctoral Fellow at Groningen in the Netherlands and also worked as Senior Fellow at University of Washington, Seattle, USA. Since 2001, he was Senior Staff Scientist at Center for DNA Fingerprinting and Diagnostics. He also served as the Director of National Center for Cell Sciences, Pune. He was awarded the Shanti Swarup Bhatnagar Prize in 2005 for Science and Technology, which is the highest science award in India. He is also the Fellow of Indian National Science Academy, National Academy of Sciences, Allahabad, and Indian Academy of Sciences, Bangalore. He has also been awarded B.M. Birla Young Scientist Award in 1999 and Bharat Asamita Tantra Vigyan Puraskar in 2009. Sir is a member of the governing body of the Indo-Prem Center for Promotion of Advanced Research and served in various key positions in various academic bodies. We welcome you, sir, and now I request you to kindly deliver the talk. Welcome, sir.
Kindly unmute yourself. Yeah, sorry. Thank you, Sharma, for the kind words. Professor Tripathi, Director of Motilal Nehru National Institute of Technology, Allahabad. All the staff, scientists, faculty, students, and family members of MNIT. First of all, my greetings to all of you on your Diamond Jubilee. आप सभी को 60 वर्ष पूर्ण करने का हार्दिक शुभकामनाएं। 60 वर्ष किसी संस्थान के लिए कुछ कम नहीं होते हैं और आप लोगों ने इतना बढ़िया काम किया है 60 वर्षों में और अभी भी कर रहे हैं। दिस इज एक्चुअली रिफ्लेक्शन ऑफ द फैक्ट that all of you have been committed to bringing quality education to the students and trying to bring technologies to the masses. I am very pleased to hear about your technology transfer. So, आप सभी को बहुत-बहुत शुभकामनाएं इस अवसर पर. Thank you also very much for inviting me to give this talk today, the inaugural talk in your series. And I thought that I should talk about the role of science and technology and innovation in the modern Indian society. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to try to project my slides here. And I do hope that you will be able to see the slides. So I hope people are able to see my slides now.
Yes, sir.
Okay. What I'm going to do is tell you a bit of history of what science and technology and innovation has played in bringing our society here. I'll be very brief in that, but what we should be doing in the coming time. I'll take roughly about 35 minutes to make my points, and after that we'll see how it goes. So if you talk of the history, you are always reminded of the quotation by Swami Vivekananda. And Swami Vivekananda was a truly a very multidisciplinary, what we call as a polymath. His wisdom spanned across many different disciplines, starting from religion to many other aspects. And he believed that we should gain knowledge only through experience. So experience is the only source of knowledge. And he actually propagated this idea even in religion. It was very surprising that many religion people who profess religion do not really say that you should gain your knowledge through experience. But Swami Vivekananda was different. He was one of the greatest personalities that our country produced in several centuries. And in the end, he says that this is the real science of religion, that experience is the real science of religion. Let us see how different countries treated this in modern times, the science and technology as a role of development in the society. And as all of you know, science has a very peculiar characteristics. Unlike religion, slightly different than religion, we always start with observations, we form a hypothesis, we make predictions, and then we set up experiments to test our hypothesis. And when we have done that, the critical elements of acceptance of our hypothesis or the way we take the knowledge to a higher level, we keep advancing the knowledge frontier, is by a system of peer review. That's number one. That is, we present our views to a large section of our peers. You know, this has been a very traditional method since ages. Even during the Vedic periods, the discussions that happened among the people who were very knowledgeable, these are the discussions which always advance the knowledge. And India had terrific knowledge developmental centers such as Nalanda, Takshila, Vikramshila. All of these were great knowledge centers in Indian history. And one common thing across all the knowledge development centers was congregation of all the knowledge people into one place and a debate among all these places about what is the current status of knowledge. And when these debates took place, some of these most profound views about how we understand the world around us, they were accepted, what we know called as paradigms. And it has been a method which has been continuously adopted by humanity as the advancement of our knowledge around us. You know, and that's what we call today as the peer review system. Typically, peer review systems can happen both in conferences or lectures, like what used to happen in Nalanda, Vikramshila, Takshila and all, or in the publications and books and all. This happens in modern times that our research publications we always put in some publication in journals or things like that. Apart from that, what we also derive is a criticism from our peers. The people around us, they criticize our ideas, and a healthy criticism that comes forward allows us to refine our ideas. And once we have finished all this entire process of peer review, conferences or lectures, publications or books, and taken into board criticism, these ideas are then accepted and become the new paradigms to go forward. The world of knowledge has always advanced by this particular method. And as I said, this tradition has been in India for several centuries. Since the pre-Vedic periods, Indians always have practiced this particular method, adopted this method for the advancement of our knowledge. Science and technology as a part of the knowledge is more recent phenomena. When we started observing nature around us, we started coming up with hypotheses. And how did different nations actually tackle in the modern times this advancement of knowledge, and how did they apply to advance their own society? Let us look at two different examples. One is the US and other is the China. Right, and these two nations we always compare ourselves with, and how do we learn, what do we learn from them? So this is one of the guiding principles that National Academy of Sciences had brought forward in 2002. I don't want to go into this, but this essentially says that we keep continuously posing questions, link our research to relevant theories, we use methods that directly investigate the question, we provide coherent and explicit chain of reasoning, we replicate and generalize different studies, and we disclose research to encourage professional scrutiny and activity. Now, in the modern era, one of the most influential essays has been written by a person called Vannevar Bush. Vannevar Bush was the scientific advisor to President Franklin Roosevelt during the war period. During the Second World War, he was a scientific advisor. And he wrote a very, very influential essay. And those of you who have not read it, it might be actually worth reading this particular essay, which says, "Science, the Endless Frontier." And in this particular essay, Vannevar Bush actually argues for adoption of science and technology, not only during the war period. In the war period, of course, we know a popular statement that is being made around the world today is that when the war started, we were still riding horses. When the war ended, we ended the war with a very unfortunate event of dropping of the atomic bomb. And in between, for 6 years, there's a tremendous progress in science that happened. And most of the progress that happened was war related. But Vannevar Bush actually argued that there is no reason that should be used. What he says is that the practices that have been used during the war periods, or the techniques that have been developed and the research experience that has been gained, should also be used in the days of peace ahead for the improvement of national health, creation of new enterprises bringing new jobs, and the betterment of national standard of living. And this actually is a very important thing, that we should use science and technology for all our endeavors. And US has adopted this very strongly since 1945, this particular approach. The second example I wanted to talk to you about was China. And many of you remember that when the Beijing Olympics took place in 1980 or something, in the 80s, China very broadly advertised its plan of how it is going to use science and technology for the development of the Chinese nation, you know? And the thing that China advertised very aggressively is that they said that ancient China's achievements, just like I mentioned about ancient India, we'll see a couple of examples from ancient India in my coming talk, but they advertised, China advertised ancient China's achievements and four of them, and they said compass, the printing press, paper, and gunpowder. And I'm very proud of this achievement that happened in China. Of course, China also had made great progress in medicine. And Chinese practices of medicine have now also been adopted in some parts of modern medicine. That's a good lesson for India to learn, that Indian medicine has also been extraordinarily well developed. The practices in Ayurveda or Yunani or other traditional practices that have been developed in India have been extraordinarily well developed. Chinese did get a setback in the Cultural Revolution in 1966. But even during that, a lady, very famous lady called Tu Youyou, she continued to work on anti-malarial therapies so that humanity can be rid of malaria. And she discovered this medicine called artemisinin. And many of you remember, a few years ago, she got the Nobel Prize for the discovery of artemisinin. So China also said that they are going to use four different methods of modernization for the country. And the four different modernization aspects of the country were agriculture, industry, national defense, and science and technology. And there is a lot to learn for a country like India to adopt something very similar. If you want to catapult India into the league of well-developed nations, we must adopt science and technology as the vehicle towards that particular goal. And this is what actually I want to say. Fortunately, what happened in India is that we have always had a society which was very empowered in doing science and technology and innovation. And I want to give you a couple of examples. This is one of the examples that comes to my mind is that how innovation has been around in Indian society for ages. Now, the example that I'm showing you here, many of you here would have seen this example. Those of you who live in hilly regions or those of you who have visited the hills in Himalayas would have seen this particular one in many different places in Himalayas. This is essentially what is called as Gharat. Gharat is actually is nothing but a flour mill. This stone on the top keeps rotating from the water that is falling due to gravity. And people bring their wheat here and grind the wheat to get the flour for daily use. And this has been used in India for 7 centuries. It is a fantastic innovation that what we see here. Since so many years, towards meeting this particular objective of getting flour from wheat. And is there even today in many parts of our hilly region. That's an innovation. How does the government support science and technology? Thousand-year-old example. The then Chola kings in Tamil Nadu, they constructed a dam on the river of Kaveri. This dam is called Kalanai Dam. It exists even today near Trichy, and this dam has been used for 2,000 years by people. And it was specifically constructed so that that region could be rid of floods, but also it can be used for irrigation. So irrigation purposes, constructing dams like this is something which is very important. And people in India or our society was aware that this kind of things can be constructed for helping the farmers. What I mean to say, the two examples that I have given you are two fantastic examples that how our society has always adopted science and technology and innovation as the vehicle for the progress of the society. This always happened since centuries in our country. But when we come to modern India, the modern India makes us even more proud of our achievements. And one of the things that India adopted when it became independent, the Indian Constitution, it hardwired the word science and scientific temper into our constitution. Now this is taken directly from the Constitution of India. The Article 51A, if you look at the H subclause, it tells you if India were to progress, we should develop scientific temper, humanism, and a spirit of inquiry and reform. We have to adopt this. So our constitution has hardwired the spirit of inquiry and reform into our daily behavior. And it's a fantastic thing. We should be ever grateful to the people who wrote our constitution, including Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar, who actually had the foresight that if the country were to develop, the country must adopt the spirit of inquiry and reform and scientific temper as one of the vehicles of our progress. It's fantastic. So when we started our journey from 1947, even before that, about 5 years before that, we had the establishment of CSIR. Now we'll come to that. But we actually faced multiple challenges. There's some disturbance from the back. I hope the disturbance is gone. Yeah. I do hope that you are still seeing my slide. We face multiple challenges, and I have roughly divided this into 4 different eras. There's the era of self-reliance, when we developed agriculture of our own, the Green Revolution, and then we also saw White Revolution a little bit later. In 1970s to 1990s was an era in which India was being denied technology from all over. There's a time when our defense technologies, the space technology and all developed extremely well. And in the Cape era of globalization, in which the first realization was that we belong to a global world and we must protect our intellectual property and so on and so forth. And now we have ambition of becoming a global science and technology powerhouse of the world. This couldn't have been highlighted better than the COVID time, in which we have nurtured, we now nurture the ambition that we must become the global science and technology innovation powerhouse of the world. Let us move ahead. I do hope that you are seeing my slide in which I have traced the history of science and technology departments and councils of India, how they came about. And as I said, the first organization in the country was 1942. There is the CSIR, the organization that I am very proudly belong to. But number of the organizations that have come into being during the post-independent India. And CSIR came into being because of several discussions that happened prior to that. And the primary individual who was there is Sir Arakkad Ramaswamy Mudaliar, who is shown here, who was responsible of moving papers and getting CSIR into being. And on 26 September 1942, Sir Shanti Swarup Bhatnagar became the first Director General of CSIR and drove CSIR into the excellence that exists today. And CSIR has contributed a large number of things since 1947 towards the development of the country. Let me give you two different examples. And the one example is that of our elections. One of our major challenges when we became independent was how do we actually bring, how do we give right to every Indian to go and vote? And many of you who have gone and voted, you remember that you come back with this indelible ink on your four fingers. This ink was developed by CSIR in 1950s. The ink that is used today, that is even used today, was developed in the 1950s in our laboratory in Delhi called the National Physical Laboratory. It's a CSIR laboratory. We developed the ink, we transferred the technology to Mysore Ink in 1961. And since then, it has been used in many, many different elections. And whole lot of people, including celebrities, are now very proudly showing that they have voted using this particular ink. That's one of the innovations that CSIR did in 1950s. However, since then, CSIR, the generic pharma industry is ever grateful to CSIR for what we have done. We have fought many separate different kinds of intellectual properties around the world, including the Haldi. And we have actually created several jobs using industries such as leather and so on and so forth over the years. More recently, we have actually come up with the different varieties of crops, such as the crop which is such as rice, which is resistant to blight, the insects. And I'm showing you here a photograph that I took last year, transferring a bag of rice to a farmer in Uttar Pradesh. And this rice is called Sambar Masuri rice. This is an improved rice which is resistant to drought. It's not genetically modified, it's only a hybrid with improved Sambar Masuri rice. And that's what we are very proud of. Our laboratory in Hyderabad, the Center for Cellular and Molecular Biology, developed this particular rice there. Very recently, about last year, we also developed technology to reduce impact on environment. And it's one of the technologies that we developed was regarding the alcohol industry. And many of you know that when we use sugarcane, we convert them into molasses. And these molasses, if they're used in distilleries to make alcohol, the byproduct that comes out of it is the effluent, what we call as spent wash. It's highly polluting, is dark in color, has obnoxious odor, has a very high BOD, and is very difficult to treat. And is a very major problem. Is it possible for us to use spent wash for some value added thing? So what we did, spent wash has two major components. One component is organics, other component are the inorganics. So we separated the organics and inorganics. Now what happens is that the organics are very rich and it can be used as animal feed for multiple reasons. So it's very good. So the organic separated organics from spent wash can now be used as animal feed. On the other hand, the inorganics that we have separated is very rich in potash. And today, the country is a net importer of potash. Potash as a fertilizer is we are a net importer. But the treated spent wash is very rich in potash and we can actually extract it out, potassium nitrate and all. What remains behind once you have extracted both the organics and inorganics is water. And this water can now be recycled for either irrigation purposes or for even used as an effluent, or you can release it in water bodies and so on and so forth. In the end, what we have achieved by this process as late as last year is a complete circular economy example. We are very proud that this forms a very proud example of what we call a circular economy. So we have sugarcane juice. The sugarcanes are converted into molasses. The molasses are used to get ethanol. That's a very profitable industry on its own. And the byproduct that comes out is the spent wash, the effluent, that is used to convert it into organics and inorganics, both of which can be used very valuably for other processes. So these are the kind of things that you want. I thought I would give an example of what CSIR has been doing till recently. We now are faced with a challenge in the post-COVID era of multiple levels. There are many, many different challenges that our country is right now facing. And many of you are aware, the Honorable Prime Minister has given a clarion call to all of us to make our country Atmanirbhar. And what is the genesis of that call? The genesis of that call is very simple. This call was given because we realized during COVID period that we are more and more and more dependent on other countries to give us even simple things. Even the medicines that we produce in the country are imported from other countries like China. And this is not healthy. Our country must become self-dependent on everything. Once we are self-dependent, we can always import things from outside. But we must show capability of self-dependence. And towards this, CSIR has taken major steps to address this particular issue. And I'm going to actually put forward some of these issues to you very quickly, what we have done, and then I will finish it there. So in next 5 or 10 minutes, let me actually tell you what CSIR is doing. If you look at what we import today in the country, then large number of things that we actually import, and this is on the left hand side panel, we see that the total 20% of all our imports are crude petroleum. But we also import gold, we also import chemicals, we also import many other things into the country. And many of these imports are from countries like China, Saudi Arabia, UAE, Iraq, and so on and so forth. And therefore, we must actually become self-dependent in all of this. And the strategy that CSIR has adopted for making us Atmanirbhar is very simple. In multiple sectors that CSIR works in, as all of you know, CSIR today has about 38 labs across the country. And the 38 labs span 38 different areas. For example, we have a lab called National Aerospace Laboratory in Bangalore. And National Aerospace Laboratory, we want to make ourselves Atmanirbhar in things like aerospace materials and coatings, lightweight materials, carbon fibers, and so on and so forth. But we also want to be very futuristic in generating what are called as high altitude, low endurance UAVs. And we have actually a strategy for making ourselves either Atmanirbhar or very futuristic by joining many different companies together, many different laboratories together. And what we have is that we have forged a collaboration with companies such as Tata's, L&T, Bharat Forge, BEL and BHL, and so on and so forth. So this is the strategy that CSIR has adopted to make ourselves Atmanirbhar in aerospace. What I want to do is tell you once again now, as CSIR works on 38 different areas, one of the areas that we work on is petroleum and natural gas. And we would also like to now reduce our imports in this particular area. And to do that, we have multiple different sources. We don't really need to have fossil sources for tapping our natural gas or petroleum requirements. What even we can do is we can use waste agri products or we can use waste food products across the country for this particular one. So the non-conventional resources such as gas hydrates, shale gas, coal-bed methanes, and also agri residues can be used to generate this kind of petroleum and natural gas or biodiesel and so on and so forth to make ourselves Atmanirbhar. And once again, we have a very standard strategy for doing this. How do we convert, for example, biogas, biomass, or even plastic waste based on chemicals to replace all the petrochemicals that what we have? So this is another very thing that what we have. Similarly, CSIR has been piloting the pharmaceuticals in the country. The entire generic pharma industry in the country is very thankful to CSIR for having made a particular industry since the 1970s or 1980s. And we have world-class facilities in many of our laboratories, such as ImTech Chandigarh, such as IICT Hyderabad, such as CDRL Lucknow, and so on and so forth. And these laboratory facilities can be used to make ourselves Atmanirbhar. CSIR has recently written a base paper along with Department of Pharmaceuticals in the Ministry of Chemicals and Fertilizers, so that we can start becoming completely self-reliant on all pharmaceutical requirements of our country. In terms of energy, we have taken some very definitive steps of making ourselves energy independent, energy in many different forms, in terms of the next gen energy sources such as lithium ion batteries, next gen sources such as hydrogen. In many of these, actually, we have taken very firm steps to develop technologies in collaboration with industry partners, which are actually listed here at the bottom of the slides. So our objective is to bring value to the society in collaboration with industry in coming times. Our focus is to develop energy solutions with greener and cleaner options. And as I said, I just mentioned, we have therefore a very strong fuel cell program which does all of this. During COVID time, we also realized that we are awfully short of our expertise in making things like medical devices and so on and so forth. And therefore, what we took up upon ourselves during the COVID period, that is last 6 months, as I said, we had formed a strategic group in March. And the strategic group's one of the objectives was to bring together people so that we can make technologies which can be made here and can be deployed here. And we did that in collaboration with many of the industries that are listed at the bottom of my slide. And we have several new technologies that we have actually brought forth for this particular one. And we have therefore strategies also for how to make India Atmanirbhar in this particular area in terms of medical devices and so on and so forth. We are very acutely aware of cleaner and greener options, as I just mentioned. And one of the things that highlights there is our water resources. The country does not have too many water resources, and we are really rapidly moving towards ourselves as what we call as a water-stressed country. We don't want our population to suffer because we are water-stressed. So what are the elegant solutions that we can do? Number one, what we can do is we can actually treat wastewater, but we can also use groundwater very judiciously without having the harmful effects of the groundwater. For example, removing fluoride, arsenic, and so on and so forth. So all the end-to-end, if you have to have solutions, we must have an end-to-end solution which we implement in the field so that the available water can be used for our own benefit. And that's the technology that we are actually developing in our labs, so that the water can be used very judiciously, so that we can halt our progress towards becoming a water-stressed country, and our population can benefit the water. Some of the very modern things which don't exist in the country, technologies such as in floriculture or fragrance, we are very actively working. As late as day before yesterday, we conducted a brainstorming meeting with many of the fragrance industry in India, and we are collaborating with this with multiple agencies such as Flavors and Fragrance Development Corporation, with Trifed, with APIDA and ICAR, and our objective is to bring value in both floriculture and fragrance, including honey, to the public. So if you can actually proliferate this at many different levels, it would be very useful. We are making several mobile-based apps. I will not go into too many of them. One of the very showcase app is Kisan Sabha, that attempts to connect the farmers with transporters. But during COVID period, we have also made an app called Arogya Path. The Arogya Path, once again, attempts to connect buyers and suppliers in all the healthcare products. So they are the kind of thing that what we are doing. So this is the kind of ecosystem that we would like to develop for self-reliance. I'm just going to rush through next few slides. They are the kind of plan that what we have to work very closely with industry to develop next-gen technologies in different CSIR labs, to promote rural technologies so that we can involve rural people in our missions, different kinds of missions, and so on and so forth. We had brought out this white paper on how do we make India Atmanirbhar in all these different things. And it is divided into multiple chapters, aerospace, chemicals, and so on and so forth. And I would welcome all of you to download this thing from our website and read this particular one. What I realize is that in today's talk here, then not only your director, not only your office staff, but also many faculty members and students are present in the talk. I would like to appeal to all of you that let us all come together and let us all think, how do we bring value from our education till now? The fantastic education such as the Motilal Nehru National Institute of Technology, Allahabad, have enabled us to think together for the next generation India. The future of India is in our hands. And if we aspire to be a nation which is on par with the most developed nations around the world, and it's actually very possible to do if we all come together. I would especially like to appeal to the students to come forward and try to see how we can deploy our technologies so that our society at large benefits. And I would like to appeal to the students to try to read some of the technology that what we have developed like this, but there are many more which have been developed by many other IITs, ISERs, NITs and so on and so forth. Please do actually download and please give a thought that what all technologies are available in the country, the local technologies. And let us all think together how we can develop, deploy these technologies for the benefit of our society, and how do we make our country very futuristic and very affluent as much as many other countries around the world. I'm almost done. What I would like to remind everyone before I stop talking are 7 guiding principles from Mahatma Gandhi. And I would like to especially address the student audience here, what Mahatma Gandhi had told us. The 7 guiding principles, I'll read both in Hindi and English. Some of the 7 sins that you should avoid are wealth without work. एक बहुत बड़ा पाप होता है जिस हम लोगों ने अवॉइड करना चाहिए, हम लोगों ने कभी नहीं करना चाहिए, जिसमें का पहला है काम के बिना धन. द सेकेंड वन ही सेड प्लेजर विदाउट कॉन्शियंस, विवेक के बिना सुख. नॉलेज विदाउट कैरेक्टर, चरित्र के बिना ज्ञान. कॉमर्स विदाउट मोरालिटी, नैतिकता के बिना व्यापार. साइंस विदाउट ह्यूमैनिटी, मानवता के बिना विकास. रिलीजन विदाउट सेक्रीफाइस, त्याग के बिना पूजा. और पॉलिटिक्स विदाउट प्रिंसिपल, सिद्धांत के बिना राजनीति. इफ वी कैन अवॉइड ऑल द 7 सिंस, दीज आर द गाइडिंग प्रिंसिपल्स दैट हैव बीन सेट फोर्थ टू अस बाय नन अदर देन अवर फादर फिगर महात्मा गांधी. आई स्टार्टेड बाय टेलिंग यू वन ऑफ द जायंट्स ऑफ इंडियन सोसाइटी, स्वामी विवेकानंद एंड हिज थॉट्स. And I'm ending with this particular thoughts of Mahatma Gandhi. And let us all resolve that we'll all work together, and we all believe that science, technology, and innovation can bring great benefit to the society. And let us all dream, it's our dream to make India one of the most advanced nations around the world in the coming few years or the coming few decades. With that resolution, let me all thank you for your attention. Thank you all very much. Thank you, Professor Tripathi, for giving me this opportunity to start this particular lecture series. And I do hope that some of your students would be would benefit by the things that I have mentioned here. Thank you all very much.
Shadma,
thank you, sir, for this inspiring and thought-provoking lecture. I have a few questions from the audience, and with your permission, I would like to ask. So the first question is that what is your vision to impart knowledge of science and technology in society?
Yes, the vision is very simple. You know, first of all, in this audience, let us have faith on science and technology and innovation, right? If we make assumption that science, technology, innovation are the major vehicles for the progress of the society, you know, then we have 2 objectives: that the scientists and technologists like us, or anyone for that matter, continuously keep innovating, right? So we have to keep promoting science, technology, and innovation amongst everyone, among the faculty, among the students, and among even general public. You know, I mean, the things like Gharat example that I gave, I don't think that particular innovation is credited to a particular individual. Someone must have thought of it. And I don't even think that particular person would have been a trained scientist or a technologist or an engineer. That person would have just got an idea, and a brilliant idea in the mind converted into a very useful innovation. Now there are many people like that around us in this particular audience. So if we try to resolve to bring science, technology, innovation to the society, there are 2 major vehicles who can do that. Number one, the society itself. The society can come forward and say that we will translate your innovation by bringing those to the society. And the vehicles for that could be things like startups, MSMEs, or people who would like to actually start their own enterprises to convert those evolutions into something very value added thing for the society. The second vehicle that we can have with us is the industry. There's a terrific example that you told me at the beginning of this particular session is that you have transferred a technology to an industry. MNNIT has transferred an innovative. It's a very proud moment for an institution like MNNIT to have transferred a technology to an industry. And that's a must if you want to bring value to the society. So the scientists and technologists, typically we work in our labs at the lab level. We can also demonstrate our technologies at the pilot level. But we don't have the capability of implementing that at a very large level. And that can only be made possible by either startups or MSMEs or larger industries. So if we do that together, that vision actually would translate India into a very, very global superpower in the coming time.
Right. Thank you, sir. So the second question that follows is that what can an institution do to enhance industry participation for research leading to innovation? That is a very interesting question.
Yeah, what the institute does is basically continuously promotes the faculty and the students with these ideas that the long-term benefit that you will see about the research that we do in the lab is by partnering with the industry, you know, and you have to continuously have interactions with industry, and all they should keep coming to the institute for talking to your faculty, students, and so on and so forth. One of the things that industry would come to you would also be because of your intellectual strength. And your intellectual strength can be demonstrated by multiple ways. Number one, that you are already doing it so well is by training the next generation human resources. That institutes like MNNIT are already doing extremely well. Right? I mean, training the next generation of human resources. That's number one, that industry can come to you. Number two, you keep publishing your results in very visible scientific journals. People around the world will see your strength through your publication. And number three, you must protect your intellectual property. If your intellectual property is protected, then no one else can use it without your consent. And with your consent means you can actually transfer that intellectual property to someone else for particular use with something, you know, so. Yeah.
Right. In this department, the institution is doing really great, I think. A lot of people would agree with that. So the third question that I would like to ask is that, this is a very interesting question, that in the light of new national education policy 2020, what role can technical institutions play in integrating multidisciplinary skill-based education in order to develop a holistic personality of youth?
That's a very nice question. The new education policy 2020 is a very, very enabling and far-sighted policy. We are all very proud that whichever group of individuals sat together and thought about making those recommendations are absolutely revolutionary. One of the things it actually tells you is that the education should be holistic. Even in higher education institutes such as IITs and NITs and all, the education must be holistic. Many of our students, for example, in the past have not been exposed to social sciences and humanities to the extent that we would wish them to. You know, even in IITs and all, social sciences and humanities are only very recent departments. And yet, even IITs and all don't focus so much on social sciences and humanities. Now that, why it is important? For the very point that I made just now, sometimes a while ago, was we must have the proper connect with the society. You know, our connect with the society can happen through startups, MSMEs, and industry. But we must have our society at the forefront of our mind. In every thinking process that what we have, society must be at the forefront of that. So we must be continuously thinking of the societal problems. And that kind of thinking can come about by having social sciences and humanities on board. If you have those kind of things available in the institute, that kind of vehicles, I'm pretty sure that students over a period of time can actually develop that kind of an ability to think of society in first. So that's the thing that I would like to state here.
Right. Thank you, sir. I hope a lot of the audience can get this answer. So now if anybody from the audience would like to interact with her, or if they have any questions, they may kindly ask now.
People have to unmute themselves to ask, probably. Probably everybody would be muted, so they should unmute and then.
Hello, sir.
Yes, please.
Thank you so much, sir, for giving us the deep insight on this topic. And I have a specific doubt. Sir, how to face that criticism part, what you have mentioned in your first slide, when we are following a MSME or we are doing a startup thing under a core or technical production area?
So, basically, if you want to have a startup of your own, there are a number of things that the government supports, that what you can do and all things like that. So you should be aware of all the different schemes for encouraging these startups. You should also find out a proper place to incubate your ideas. So some good incubation centers would offer you facilities. They would also offer you mentorship. But to translate that idea at a larger scale, you will need help from people who understand finance very well, the people who understand management very well. So those kind of things actually would be useful to have on board with those people. So maybe you should try to connect with those kind of things and then start thinking of having a startup together, something like that.
Okay, thank you so much, sir. It cleared my doubt.
Shadma, I may have to leave pretty soon. I have a call from Honorable Mantri Ji. So I hope I can leave now with your permission.
Yes, sir.
Oh, yes.
Yes, sir. So I'll take over now from Shadma.
Right.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Seriously, if you were lecturing us physically in a hall, there would have been a big round of applause. So I just wanted to thank from all of us for your ingenuity, your information, and most importantly, motivating. The key words which I was actually noting down, if we see that Atmanirbhar Bharat is the future of India, so we have to look at green innovation, we have to look at industry participation. And sir, wonderfully, you presented your last slide in which you gave 12 sectors. So I'm sure that our young faculty and students will definitely take advantage of that. And I thank you from deepest regards, also from our director, sir, and from all the faculty, students, participants, and organizers. And sir, we will wait for the good times when we can invite you personally to come to our campus and be with us for a day for similar activity. Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you.
And namaskar.
Jai.
Thank you very much, sir.